One of the big ways that working in Antarctica is a little bit different than a lot of the other places that we hunt for fossils is how we find them on the surface, because Antarctica is technically a desert, right? It's not getting a lot of precipitation, and things are very, very cold there most of the time. So you actually don't get a lot of, at least in the areas that we're at, you don't get a lot of unweathered or weathered rock and kind of pebbly rock at the surface, where places like Ghost Ranch, New Mexico, or the Four Corners area of Utah, or kind of Badlands National Park, when you kind of picture those or look at images, you see that very pebbly texture of the rock on the surface that we sometimes call popcorn, because it looks like it's breaking apart, you know, because it's been getting wet and the clays and everything have expanded and contracted when it heats and dries again, and that breaks up the rock on the surface. And we don't have that as much in Antarctica, because we're not getting that precipitation and that kind of that much variation in the temperature. And so when we're finding things, we're generally finding flecks and bits of bone and stuff that aren't kind of broken apart and kind of strewn down, you know, a little channel or something like that. We're finding them in place. That's really handy because the stuff on the surface isn't as chipped and busted and broken up, but it does mean that the rock itself is still very hard. And so most of the excavation we were doing at this last trip in the Shackleton Glacier was with large kind of concrete saws, these big rock saws, where we would kind of cut channels around the fossil and then use hand tools to kind of chisel out large blocks with the fossil. Where our dinosaurs are actually from, on Mount Kirkpatrick near the Beardmore Glacier, that rock is a very, very hard kind of silicified sedimentary rock, and it's almost like concrete. And so there, we use rock saws as well, but we also even had to bring in big 50 or 60 pound jackhammers, some electric jackhammers, some drills where we're actually drilling holes in and then sinking in kind of these little feathers and wedges. So kind of two little iron spikes on the side with a central spike that you'd put in and then hammer down to kind of help split the rock along a line of holes that you've bored in there. And we're just trying to calve off big, you know, 800 pound chunks of block that we can take back. At that site where the dinosaurs are from, you can't have a block that's so big that it can't be moved at all, right? So, you know, you get down to a size that at least, you know, a couple of people can get around it and kind of shimmy it and shift it, maybe get it on a sled or something that they can slide and pull it down. But for the dinosaur site, what we had to do is get those blocks shored up. We would then wrap them in a big cargo net with a chain and a hook on it, and we would have our helicopter pilots would come up and have to hover over, in most cases it was our mountaineer, Peter Braddock from New Zealand, that would have to actually make that connection, hook that cargo net up, and then the helicopter would lift off and take that off. And they have certain specifications too, so they, on the one side, they don't want to take a whole bunch of weight because they're flying at altitude, but on the other side, they want the jacket, the weight that we put in there, to be above a minimum amount so that it doesn't swing around so much when they're flying back to camp. So we tried to kind of get that sweet spot for every jacket we were pulling out.